We are continuing our exploration of the methodology of scientific reasoning, and we're looking at part three here is on Bayes' theorem in our exploration of the hypothetico-deductive method. So we're focusing in entirely on Bayes' theorem in this video. Now, there is going to be math, okay? Bayes' theorem involves math. So, there's your warning right up front. So when do you use Bayes' theorem? Well, the general idea is that you have some evidence. So you already have an hypothesis, you've gathered some evidence, and you want to know to what extent that evidence confirms or disconfirms your hypothesis. So this is the situation you find yourself in. You already have an hypothesis, you've gathered evidence. Now, to what degree is your hypothesis confirmed? We've talked about how confirmation comes in degrees and increments. And so Bayes' theorem is a way to measure that, right? Bayes' theorem can be used to provide a model then for arguments, reasoning related to confirmation or disconfirmation of hypotheses. So this is a way of putting some numerical criteria on the degree to which something's confirmed or even disconfirmed. So let's start with an application, kind of a silly situation, but just to get our feet wet here with Bayes' theorem, let's think about Grenault and the coin. So we have a situation where Grenault, and you know Grenault, that Grenault's always joking around, and you suspect that Grenault's coin is unfair. So you see Grenault coming up to somebody and saying, hey, I bet you I can flip this quarter three times and get three heads in a row. And but you're suspicious that Grenault's going to be cheating this person. So let your primary hypothesis be that the coin is unfair. You're thinking, ah, he's using an unfair coin. That's what's going on here. And then the negation of that hypothesis is going to be that the coin is fair. It's just a regular coin, and he's just out for a little entertainment, even if he's going to lose money in the process. Okay, so Bayes' theorem now is going to be useful to confirm or disconfirm that hypothesis about Grenault's coin being a fair or an unfair coin, and it gives us a numerical measure of the degree of confirmation. So we need to be able to gather some evidence now. So what you're going to do is watch and see what happens when Grenault flips the coin three times, and that's going to provide some evidence. And then you can calculate now how likely it was that Grenault was cheating. Now, in order to do this, in order to do Bayes' theorem in any context, you do have to know some prior probability. So you have to be familiar with the subject matter at hand. And you have to have some prior probabilities that must be known. So what prior probabilities? Well, in this case, let's assume you know Grenault well enough to think that there's about an 80% chance that he's cheating, that he's using an unfair coin. Well, we'll just assign that value a prior probability that the hypothesis is true, that the coin is unfair, then is 0.8. Now, what's happening, though, is you want to gather some evidence. You're going to observe. You see what happens with the coin flips. And then we'll have a degree of confirmation of that hypothesis or disconfirmation. Now, the probability that the prediction, the observed outcome, and the evidence, in other words, in this case, that there are, in fact, three heads on three coin flips, would have happened if the hypothesis was true. You need to know that probability. And you also need to know the probability if the hypothesis was false. And so in these cases, we can fill in some numbers here. So for example, of our situation at hand, the probability of getting three heads with three tosses of an unfair coin, and we'll just assume it's a double-sided coin, it's a guarantee, you're going to get it. So it's a one, right? Maximal probability. And the probability of getting three heads in a row with three tosses of a fair coin is, well, you have a 0.5 chance on the first time, a 0.5 chance on the second time, 0.5 chance on the third time. These are independent probabilities. So we can calculate that by multiplying those together, 0.5 times 0.5 times 0.5, and that gives us 0.125. So we now know we've got the probability of getting the evidence if the hypothesis is true, and we have the probability of getting the evidence if the hypothesis is false. Now, the third thing we need to know is we can start doing some calculations here, and that's the probability that the observed outcome, the evidence itself, would occur without regard to whether the hypothesis is true. So here we're not going to assume it's true. We're not going to assume it's false. This is the total probability for the evidence statement. And there's a formula to do this. I've warned you about the math. Here we go. So the formula for calculating this is you take the first part, the probability of the hypothesis itself. Now we know that's 0.8, right? That we're using an unfair coin. The probability of getting the evidence on the hypothesis, that's what the vertical line there between the E and the H, that having the evidence given the hypothesis, and we said that was one, so we'll put those numbers out in just a moment, and you're going to add that to the probability of the negation of the hypothesis, and that's just going to be one minus the probability of the hypothesis. So in this case, we said it's a 0.8 probability that Grenold is using an unfair coin, so it's going to be one minus 0.8, and that'll give us 0.2. And then let's start putting some of these numbers out here at the bottom there. So we have the 0.8 times 1, and we're going to add that to the 0.2, and then we take that times the probability of getting the evidence that there's three heads, given that the hypothesis is false, that is, given that we have a fair coin, and we just mentioned that that was 0.125. So now we just have to do the math. It's just a matter of calculating this out. So the probability that the observed outcome would occur, and we're not assuming the hypothesis is correct. We're not assuming it's false. We just know the relationship now between the hypothesis, the negation of the hypothesis, and the evidence at hand. So we have that 0.8 times 1. That's our 0.8. Of course, we're going to add that times result of 0.2 times 0.125, which is 0.025. And we add those together and we get 0.825. Now, this isn't Bayes' theorem yet, but it's a crucial part of Bayes' theorem. In fact, what we've just done is we've shown how we calculate the denominator for Bayes' theorem. So, what do we have for Bayes' theorem? Here's the whole theorem at hand. We see in the denominator that formula that we just calculated. The numerical value that we calculated was 0.25. Now, what's going in the numerator? Well, it's the probability of the hypothesis. We said that was 0.8, and that's multiplied times the probability of getting the evidence we have, that is three heads, on the hypothesis, given that the hypothesis is true, and that's 1. So we have our 0.8 times 1, or 0.8. And so we have 0.8 over 0.825. And when we calculate that out, we have 0.97. So if we see Grenold in this situation, we know it's likely that he's to be a cheater. We've gathered some evidence. And since 0.97, now we can call that the posterior probability, that is the probability after we've already gained some evidence. And that's significantly higher than the 0.8 that we started with. So that's an upper left hand here on the screen, the probability of the hypothesis given the evidence is 0.97. That's a lot higher than just the probability of the hypothesis on its own, 0.8. So the hypothesis is confirmed. Now, what does that mean? Well, that's a pretty good confirmation. So we have good reason to think that Grenold, who of course, is a known prankster, is in fact cheating in this situation, that he is in fact using an unfair coin, a two-headed coin, something like that. Okay, now that's kind of an obscure situation where Bayes' theorem is useful, but not the kind of thing that we use in science typically. So let's make sure that we have an example here from science. So let's use Bayes' theorem to test an hypothesis that we might actually be interested in. And this is one that's much more serious than coin flips. This is about colon cancer. So suppose that Drindle tests positive for colon cancer. Now, I'm using a probability from decades ago, and we don't have any other data than related to the cancer. Sorry, the CA capitalized, that's cancer. We have no other data related to the cancer available. So we're not taking into consideration Drindle's heredity, his background in other ways, his environmental exposures. None of that is being taken into consideration for our purposes here. We're just focusing in on the positive test for colon cancer. Now, the treatment for colon cancer, of course, is painful. It's dangerous. You don't want to go through it unless you're sure you have colon cancer. So you should avoid the treatment if it's not necessary, right? Of course, obviously. So you don't just want to jump in just because Drindle tests positive. He doesn't go straight to treatment, especially given some of our information here. So since the test for colon cancer is not perfect, and this is the case with medical tests, this is very common, they're not perfect. In other words, sometimes you get false positives. So you go and test for a COVID, for example. Sometimes there are false positives. And sometimes, though, there are false negatives. You actually have whatever is at issue, but the test says you don't. So that's the case with the test for colon cancer. It can say that you have it when you, in fact, don't. And sometimes you might have it, but it doesn't say that you do. So on both sides, it might err. And this is unfortunately common with tests for diseases are not perfect. So in order to assess in this situation whether to undergo treatment for colon cancer, we have to make some further considerations. Again, though, this is somewhat artificial because we're putting off to the side any other relevant information besides the positive test. But we do have some relevant information. We know, for example, that the probability that a person in the general population has colon cancer is very low. It's 0.003. So it's just on the surface, it's unlikely that any given person has colon cancer, right? That's a low probability. And we also know about this test that if a person has colon cancer, then the probability that the test is positive is 0.5. Now, so in other words, this test will catch half the people who have colon cancer, right? Half the people who in fact have colon cancer, this test will say that they do have colon cancer. Now that is useful. It's not a great test. And in fact, I said this was from decades ago. So contemporary as I record this, over-the-counter colon cancer tests have a much higher probability. Theirs is about 0.9, 0.92 in that range. So we've improved these tests, but that's not always the case. And we're going with 0.5 in this example. Now, if the person does not have colon cancer, then the probability that the test is positive, this is a false positive, obviously, is 0.03. So you have the probability that you get a false negative at 0.5, the probability of false positive is 0.03. So that's a lot better on that side. And so the test isn't bad when we consider that. Now, given all that information, again, putting aside heredity, environmental exposures, those things, just focusing in on the test itself, what we know about the test, and that Drendel tested positive, what's the probability that Drendel actually has colon cancer? Now, I asked Russ rough estimate here. They actually did a survey of physicians given information like this, and many of the physicians just, so these are obviously smart, intelligent people. What they did, though, was they just took the 0.5 and they subtracted the 0.03 and they came up with 0.47. That was the most common answer among the physicians. And so they were saying, yeah, test positive is about a 50-50 chance in that range that the person has colon cancer. So that's pretty bad news if you test positive. But let's use Bayes theorem to be much more careful with this. So what do we want? What's our situation? We want to know the probability that Drendel has colon cancer. So that's our hypothesis. And we have some evidence. Given that we know that Drendel's test for colon cancer was positive. So that's our evidence, E. So we go to Bayes theorem. Well, before we do, just to make sure we're clear, in this case, the negation of that hypothesis is going to be Drendel does not have colon cancer. And just without any evidence at all, we have some numbers and we can put that all in. So what does Bayes theorem do? Again, on your left here on this formula, the probability of the hypothesis being true, given the evidence, and then we have the formula where we can fill in our numbers. That's what how we will determine that number. So what numbers do we have? Well, taking the numerator here, the probability of the hypothesis being true, and we're taking that times the probability of getting the hypothesis, I'm sorry, getting the evidence, getting the positive test, given the hypothesis that Drendel has colon cancer, well, that is 0.003. That's just the broad general population probability that Drendel has colon cancer. And we're multiplying it times 0.5, the likelihood that we get the evidence, given that, assuming that the hypothesis is true, that Drendel does have colon cancer. Now, notice the numerator is exactly the same as the left-hand portion of the denominator. And so we have that same number repeated over there, 0.003 times 0.5. And then we're adding that to the probability of the negation of the hypothesis, which is going to be 1 minus 0.003. So that's where we're getting our 0.997. And then we're going to multiply it times the probability of getting the evidence, the positive result, on the assumption that the hypothesis is false. So that would be a false positive, and we have that data. It was 0.03. So we start just doing the math. On the top, the numerator, we have 0.003 times 0.5. That's 0.0015. And on the bottom, we have 0.0015 on the right-hand side. We're adding that to 0.029. We've rounded off to the nearest three digits here. And we do the addition and we get 0.049. Now, what did we say the physicians estimated the probability was that Drendel had colon cancer? Their common answer was 0.47. Well, 0.049 is you're in a much better situation than 0.47. So given the accuracy of the test, even though Drendel tested positive, there's only around a 5% chance that he's actually got colon cancer. So things are a lot more positive in this situation than Drendel or the physician may initially assume. However, that's significantly higher than the general population probability, than the prior probability of the hypothesis, very significantly higher. So it means we definitely want Drendel to have some more tests. We need to explore more carefully to see if there's other evidence that Drendel has colon cancer. And that's the kind of thing that Bayes theorem can do for you. It can evaluate the evidence that you have and tell you how likely it is that your hypothesis is true based on that evidence. And it is very useful in all sorts of scientific disciplines, social sciences and natural sciences alike. And so this is something that's a tool that is good to be familiar with if you're exploring and doing reasoning in either any science whatsoever.